McLean could have someone on her other side.
So education technology has always been around since the beginning of schooling in the U.S. So we've had paper, pencils, slates. But what has really changed over the last two decades has been that we've moved from kind of a whole group instruction with technology, where technology was really supplementing what was already happening in the classroom. And now what we're seeing are classrooms where there's this idea of personalizing and individualizing instruction through technology. We also don't necessarily see the students doing the same things on their devices anymore. Students could be using the same piece of software, but doing very different things with it based on their learning interests, based on their differentiated learning levels.
So we don't have to teach to the whole and wait for everybody to get to a certain place before we move to the next place in the continuum of learning. And this enables us to meet kids' needs in ways that are where they're at. So when they're ready to move, they're able to move.
Even though the other three kindergarten teachers are considerably younger than I am, I am actually the one who uses technology the most and is always looking for new ways to use technology in the classroom. And so they love it when I share ideas of things, oh, I found this, we can do this together in the class. I don't start with technology, and I don't start that technology is what I want to use, so what am I going to teach? What I do is figure out what is it I want to teach, and is there a way that technology can make that a better experience?
So we have our one main classroom, which is called our 21st century classroom. When you first walk in, you're going to notice whiteboard walls. We call those the idea walls that you can actually write on just like a whiteboard. Our tables are movable for different configurations, but they also are whiteboard material on the tables. The other thing in the classroom we found is that we're able to differentiate instruction, meaning that maybe a group that needs more time on a concept, they work at one table, but there may be another group that needs to accelerate, and so the teacher has the ability to display different things depending on what the students need.
So each one is a math problem.
A lot of kids process by talking, listening to other people think and how they think about problems, and their modeling their thinking is a powerful way to ignite learning in kids. And so anytime we can put them in a collaborative group where they're hearing other people process in a structured way, my job then is, how do I set up tasks and conversations so that my kids can build the blocks for each other to get there? Having spaces like that have pushed me to be better at moving away from the stage, moving away from being the expert in the room, partnering up more with kids in that way.
What we have found is if you wait to give teachers directions, it slows the whole process down. So making sure that the teachers know that they have permission to try things that they know will meet the needs of their learners in the classroom, I think is one of the things that's a great asset here. I have found that if you plant the initiative or plant the goals, then the teachers find ways to accomplish that. They are the best teachers of each other for things that work well for students. You know, it used to be that as a teacher, you'd walk into the classroom and you had a textbook that you taught from, and you taught the lesson and you tested the kids at the end, and the learning was very stagnant. What we do now is we have the Common Core for a basis for what needs to be taught. But the teachers do a lot of pre-assessing. The teachers use a lot of technology to, number one, engage the kids, number two, get feedback constantly from the kids on their learning, and then number three, instead of taking a test at the end of the unit, let's create a project that shows me what you know.
Does that make sense?
It's a rather intimidating process, I think, for people to like learn along with students. Mm-hmm. So I think we're pretty candid. I'm learning with you. Oh, I made an error, so don't do that. But we usually try and infuse it into our lessons.
Modeling all the way. Model.
Yeah, to make it like seem very natural for us. So this is how you use it. This is the mistake that you can make with it. And then the we do, we all go and do it together. And then, of course, the you do, you go and do it on your own.
And I think that's important that they see us make those mistakes, because sometimes with tech, it can seem not super user-friendly with, you know, certain systems. And so it's like, well, we just saw Miss Barry mess up, and she figured it out eventually. And so that struggle is good sometimes. So being able to push beyond the struggle with using those tools is important.
So the National Education Technology Plan has a new focus for teachers, which is really wanting and recognizing that for teachers to use technology effectively, they need a lot of professional development. Many of our teachers did not grow up using technologies. They did not grow up seeing teachers using technologies effectively. Some of them were not even trained when they went through their teacher preparation programs because it was long enough ago that they didn't have those opportunities.
We constantly talk about differentiated learning and how you can't teach to the whole anymore. It's just, it's not fair to students. You have to meet students where they are. And for teachers, that becomes a very difficult job because now I'm not teaching to one entire group. I have 25 individuals who need different kinds of things each and every day. And so technology, especially one-to-one technology, can differentiate that learning for the student.